This video is sponsored by the Big Bads Kickstarter from Hit Point Press. Hello and welcome to Monster of the Week, the only show on the internet that openly advocates for more insect hybrid super soldiers. In my lengthy video about the Spirit Warrior, between all the Evangelion memes, I briefly mentioned the existence of a race of creatures literally bred for war and scientifically engineered by elves to be mutant insect soldiers. I also talked some mad shit about their artwork. And apparently that was all it took to pique the interest of half the comment section, so today, we're talking about bionoids. We're gonna talk about their lore, we're gonna talk about their ecology, and you better believe we're gonna talk about some plot hooks and ways you might actually use them in your D&D campaign. Also, we're gonna convert them from 2nd edition D&D into 5th edition D&D because my mission is to make sure these absolutely horrific creatures end up in the hands of as many DMs as humanly possible. Now, let's learn everything there is to know about these horrible insect people. Once again, we are heading back to the AD&D 2nd Edition Monstrous Compendium Spelljammer Appendix to find the origin of our monster this week. They're described as being 10 foot tall, chitinous, bipedal, humanoid insect hybrids. And that, in and of itself, isn't entirely unlike a bunch of other monsters we've seen a thousand times before in D&D. But what makes the bionoid a little spicy in comparison is that it comes with something we don't often see associated with many of these monsters, a heaping tablespoon of body horror. Bionoids are entirely unnatural in their creation. In fact, their species began, effectively, as a war crime. In one of the two massive wars that took place in the Spelljammer universe, known as the Unhuman Wars, the Elven Empire felt like they were on the back foot. While they did have lots of very powerful magic on their side, anytime they got into close combat with the orcish and goblinoid armies, they found themselves at a distinct disadvantage. So naturally, they started a super soldier program. This involved taking elven soldiers and subjecting them to a ton of permanent magical procedures. Their skin was altered into thick chitinous armor plating, their musculature was enhanced, making them much stronger and nearly doubling their size, and of course, the insectile essence they were infused with caused their body to sprout massive arm blades and mandibles. In fact, their head transformed entirely to house two large compound eyes. The end result was a soldier who could stand up to the might of even the most powerful orcish combatant. Now, I don't know if the astral elves have an equivalent of the Geneva Convention in their world, but this feels like it should have violated some kind of law. The most crucial part of this transformation was the crystalline gem that was embedded into the forehead of every subject. This soul gem was used to channel the magic, and it also serves a very important purpose beyond just looking cool, because this gem acts as a failsafe if the bionoid is ever killed. When their body is destroyed, the bionoid's soul is trapped within the gem, and then it falls to the ground. It will lay there, dormant, until another humanoid creature physically touches it. When that happens, the crystal will react by merging itself with the creature and essentially hijacking their body. The crystal will then feed off the energy of its victim until it can fully form a new bionoid shell around the victim's body, at which point it detaches itself and goes on with its life. This process is ultimately harmless to the host, however, depending on who or what the host is, it might cause other problems. Also, it's really gross. I should also mention that this bionoid gem is not indestructible. And as long as no humanoid creature actually touches it, the gem, and by extension the bionoid, are essentially helpless. But assuming the bionoid forces were victorious in battle, they could easily just collect the gems of their fallen brethren and regrow them back at the ranch. Because of this, bionoids fight with zero fear of death. For even if their body is destroyed, as long as their team wins, they can just shake it off and get back to doing a war in no time. While this whole process of transforming elven soldiers into bionoids might seem callous at best, it's worth noting that the elves who were made into these horrible insect nightmares did so as volunteers. They knew exactly what they were getting into and chose to do it in order to save their people, which is pretty noble in my opinion. The thing that makes this whole situation absolutely gut-wrenching is what happened to the bionoids after the war was over. Once the war had concluded, the Elven Empire no longer had any need for the Bionoids. So how did they honor these mutant super soldiers who had sacrificed literally everything in order to protect their kin? Well, by banishing them from the kingdom, of course. They were disgusted by the Bionoids because they reminded the elves of the war, and also because they were horrific insect people. So they were allowed to live, just not anywhere near their friends, family, or culture. You know, the friends, family, and culture they had sacrificed everything to save. The Bionoids didn't exactly appreciate this, but they weren't about to turn on their own people either. After all, the elves who became Bionoids did so of their own free will as a means to protect other elves. So even when their people turned away from them, they chose to just go quietly into the night and disperse into far-off lands. Though they would never forget the way that they were treated, and as a result, many Bionoids are slow to trust those from Elven lands, and I think that's perfectly reasonable. Now earlier, I had mentioned the Spirit Warrior, another quasi-war crime created by the Astral Elf Empire. The Bionoid has even more in common with that creature than you might initially realize. For one, they were both created by Newton Ewell, which, all things considered, totally tracks. And for two, they were both inspired by anime. Okay, so as we already established in the Spirit Warrior video, a bunch of stuff from Spelljammer was inspired by various animes of the time. And the Bionoid is certainly no exception. If you took one look at this creature and immediately thought, hey, that's a Guyver, you'd be 100% correct. Bio Booster Armor Guyver is an 80s manga turned anime that is directly responsible for the Bionoid's existence. Obviously, they're nearly identical from an aesthetic point of view, but what I find most interesting is where things diverge a bit from the source material. Obviously, the designer of this monster needed to make it fit into Spelljammer and by extension, Dungeons and Dragons. Also, they probably didn't want to get sued, so we gotta make it a little bit different. In the anime, the Guyver suit is a weird disc-like object that attaches itself to a sentient creature and essentially transforms them into a super soldier. However, when they aren't in full-on Guyver mode, the host is able to suppress the tech and live their life as a normal-ass human. And that is pretty much the only major difference. The Bionoid is otherwise a direct one-to-one imagining of the Guyver suit in the D&D universe, or multiverse, I guess. The verse of some kind. But before we move on, just full disclosure on this one, I haven't had a chance to read the manga or watch the Guyver anime, so there might be a few things here that I'm actually missing. I ordered the Blu-ray on Amazon, but it did not get here on time. So if there are any Guyver enthusiasts watching right now, I look forward to reading your comments. One thing I do think is worth noting, however, is that in the anime, the Guyver suits can open up a cannon in their chest that seems to just disintegrate anyone and anything in front of them. And that's an ability that did make its way onto the Spelljammer stat block.
Life, an infinite energy beyond scientific understanding. Now, this energy has been transformed into a new weapon.
When it comes to combat prowess, there isn't a whole lot to really talk about the Bionoid that makes it extremely unique from other humanoid creatures. They are genetically modified super soldiers, which means they are extremely competent in battle, and they're basically gonna act as highly effective soldiers. They can make attacks with their arm blades that will slice most things in half, they have a powerful stomp attack they can take as a bonus action if they jump onto their enemy, and they have a trait detailing the specifics of the soul gem in their forehead and how all that works. The one thing that really seems to just kinda come out of left field for the Bionoid in combat is the aforementioned chest cannon.
Pariah's from downtown! Yes! He's really showing us what a man with a cannon in his chest can do!
The incineration membrane can only be used once per day before it needs to recharge. When the Bionoid does choose to unleash it, it's gonna cause 11d6 fire damage to anyone and everything in a 30-foot cone. It's basically an upcast fireball that targets a more specific area, which is terrifying. This ability is gonna punch slightly above the weight of your average CR6 creature. However, this is because the ability has a drawback. In addition to only being usable once per day, this attack also harms the Bionoid. It's almost like having a cannon in your chest isn't the most viable option if you want to not have your body ripped apart with force damage. So bionoids typically keep this on lock unless it's the most viable strategic option. If they use this ability, it's almost always because they think they're about to be destroyed, so they might as well cause as much damage as possible first, or because they think the extra burst of damage will be enough to quickly finish off multiple enemies and end the battle. Plus, this isn't necessarily a borderline suicidal maneuver per se, because as long as the crystal survives, even if the bionoid's body is destroyed, it can always regenerate later. But as I mentioned, the place where the bionoid really shines is in their lore and just the mere fact that they exist and what the implications of that are. I think there are a lot of unique ways this creature might show up in a story, so let's talk about that.
Oops.
So, how do we make use of the bionoid? As humanoid creatures that typically fall somewhere near the line of neutrality on the alignment chart, there are so many options. They can be heroes, villains, bystanders, carnies, the sky's the limit. The source material often talks about how bionoids often settle in remote parts of the world. So if your players are traveling through a strange and faraway land, a colony of bionoids could be a pretty cool place to encounter. While they are largely peaceful these days, they maintain their warrior culture as a means of honing discipline and defending themselves should the need arise. Most other peoples are frightened of bionoids at first, and I mean, given their appearance, it's kind of hard to blame them, but they will often come around to the idea and find that having bionoid neighbors is kind of awesome. Small towns and settlements often engage in trade with bionoids and really appreciate having reasonable allies that can also kick some serious ass if a threat ever presents itself. For this reason, wise kingdoms will often seek out nearby bionoid settlements and try to befriend them. And this could be a really great opportunity for a peculiar adventure. Maybe the players are all part of a kingdom that is on the precipice of being invaded by a more expansionist empire. So they're desperate and seeking allies in the fight, and they decide to send a group of emissaries to the nearby bionoids to see if they can negotiate some kind of agreement. The players will then have to navigate a very new and different culture while also trying to achieve a very specific goal. And who knows, maybe the bionoids will agree to help the players if the players fulfill some other sort of requirement. I also like the idea of the players being from a small village, and perhaps there are rumors of monster sightings nearby. When they go to investigate, they find a new bionoid encampment. Then it's up to them to make peace or fight them off, and either way, I think that would be pretty interesting. There's also the potential angle of doing something with that soul gem that every bionoid has. Maybe the players come across some long-lost soul gems and inadvertently end up resurrecting the bionoids within. Are they enemies? Allies? Just trying to find the nearest Arby's so that it may be destroyed? Whatever the case, that could be an interesting story beat too. Maybe they've just been lying dormant since the war and have no idea what the current state of affairs is, so the party has a chance to help them find their people. Maybe the bionoids tell the players that they were created to fight on behalf of this elven empire, so the players actually help guide them back to the elves only to find out that they've been banished 1,000 years ago. There's a lot of different stuff you could do here, ranging from political intrigue to an all-out war, and I'll leave that up to you to figure out. Speaking of doing lots of stuff, let's take a moment to hear from this week's sponsor, The Big Bads Kickstarter. You've heard of the bestiary, now check out the bostiary. Tangle with a mischievous sea dragon, foil the schemes of a gelatinous kingpin, and face down world-ending threats. Big Bads is a two-volume collection of the biggest, baddest boss monsters from 5th edition, now on Kickstarter. More than just mere stat blocks, every Big Bad comes equipped with full backstories, tactics, minions, and much more. Build a campaign or run a one-shot around these thrilling villains with over 25 boss monsters and a compendium of over 100 monsters and magic items. Big Bads is live on Kickstarter, and you can check it out by going to bigbads.com or simply by following the link in the description below. The project was literally funded within 30 minutes of going live, so do with that information what you will. Thank you so much to the Big Bads Kickstarter and Hit Point Press for bringing us here today to talk about insectoid anime men. I really appreciate it. And thank you so much to all the awesome patrons out there who literally make this show possible with their support. And a special thank you to this week's randomly selected Patron of the Week.
Thank you so much, Zinc. I appreciate every trace of your support immensely.
And thank you for watching.
As always, I have, of course, converted this monster into 5th edition, and you can find the stat block for this creature linked in the description down below in the form of a Google document. And if you are one of my aforementioned lovely patrons, you can, of course, find the Dungeon Dad Monster Manual high-res PDF-style stat block over on the Patreon page. All the information is the same. It just looks fancy and gives you a neat thing to stick in your DM folder and helps support me in the content that I'm trying to make here. But either way, whether you're going to Patreon or just the regular stat block, everything you need is in the description down below. Also, if there is a monster from an older version of D&D or any other tabletop role-playing game that you would like to see converted into 5th edition and talked about on the channel, please let me know either in the comment section down below or over in the Dungeon Dad Discord channel. We have a monster suggestions page there where all of that information is lovingly compiled by our monster master. This is a subtle shout out to Caden. I appreciate all of the extra work you put in helping me manage that document. It makes my life markedly easier when I go to try to figure out what the next week's monster is gonna be. So thank you. Also, while you're on the Discord, you can check out the Dungeon Dad Discord Creature Creation Contest. Man, that's a mouthful. DDDCCC, hashtag DDDCCC. Which is a contest where all members of the community who want to submit their own homebrew monsters do so with a general theme, and then everyone gets to vote on which ones they like, and yeah, it's just a cool, there's no big prize, it's just a fun thing that we do with the community, which is run by the mod team over there. And also, big shout out to all of you guys, I appreciate the work you do helping me manage the chaos that is the server and all of our cool contests and stuff. All in all, again, just want to say thank you so much for watching. Try not to get fooled today, and I'll see you in the next one. Until then.
Dungeon Dad is back in the saddle with a creature sure to silence all naysayers. But is this truly the next creature to trot its way onto the show? Or is it merely April Fools? Next episode, horses. Gallop on in next time for lots more fan service.